playtime's over, because tonight somebody's gonna get their ass whooped tonight in here.
Why do I run and why do I hide when I see it coming further on down the line? Why do I sing and why do I write these songs? I know I'll try to these thoughts of mine, but the springs arrive as I just wait.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Bowling Shoe Handsome for Monday, February 13th, 2012. I'm your host, Kevin McElvinney, and with me here, as always, is ubiquitous Young John. Young John, extend greetings to our loyal listeners.
Kevin, I'm ready for death.
All right, that's a bleak way to begin this midwinter edition of Bowling Shoe Handsome. What's wrong?
Sick.
Sick of what? Sick of this show? Sick of...
I'm sick of germs invading my body.
Oh, that kind. All right.
I'm sick. I got the itis.
You ate too much?
Wrong itis. I have the common cold.
Oh. All right. I thought you had like a big turkey dinner or something. You were tired. Too much gravy.
I got the bubble gut.
You know something, tryptophan? I'm not a fan.
Anyway. Oh, I see what you did there.
Yeah. Saw what you did there.
Did you see what I did there?
I saw what you did there.
Nobody else sees what we're doing there. Inside jokes are rude.
The A-Tills gets it. I told him we mentioned him last week. He was happy.
Better be.
Yeah. Anyway, so tonight's topic, Young John, I kind of wanted to talk about this trend. It's not exactly new, but it's just... pretty obnoxious to me sometimes.
Bracelets? Is it?
They're coming back.
Are they really slap bracelets?
Yeah, I've seen them at. I think I saw them at Walgreens or something. They were right at the front counter. Yeah.
I'm still pissed that they got banned.
What, at like schools and stuff?
Yeah.
I thought you were gonna say from the United States. I was like, slap bracelets and absinthe.
Yeah.
Legal elsewhere, but
yeah,
not in the U.S. Anyway. No, the trend that has not been banned is cool heels. Cool, what do I mean by this? Heels. Yes, and I don't mean that one does not have adequate pant coverage and that the backs of their ankles are chilly. What I am talking about is wrestling heels and their need to act cool all the time. And there's one thing, you know, acting cool, but another is doing it for sort of this mixture of positive and negative attention, if that makes sense. I'm talking about currently someone like Dolph Ziggler, who is the hashtag heel Ziggler on Twitter, yet interacts very positively and jovially and amicably with all of his followers, talks himself up a great deal, but really there's not a trace of heel attitude on here. It's just a guy who's like overly confident, you know, and people, I don't know. This is a positive set of vibes that he puts forward. People in the past who've done this, Randy Orton, Edge used to do this to a great extent. You know, he would come out as a heel and still like go and pan over to the crowd, go up to people, like engage with them. I don't get that. The heel should not be engaging with the crowd in this way. And I think there are these guys who, rather than actually getting legitimately booed and disliked for the sake of the product, want to be like an awesome bad guy. And that bothers me. Is what I'm saying making sense, John?
Yeah, it does. You know, this whole social network, the social media, the social networking, it's being shoved down our throats by every, you know, outlet. And, you know, what I was thinking once you started saying this was maybe he's just following what he's supposed to do. Maybe WWE is asking them to do this. And then I got to thinking maybe WWE is using his Twitter sometimes and is just answering these questions. More so, it's probably Dolph Ziggler answering his own tweets. But I feel like they want it to be positive, even though he's a heel. They want it to be positive because – that's just the reaction they want to receive. They want a well-liked reaction for the product.
All right. Well, what about some of the other guys then?
Like CM Punk?
Yeah, like...
Have you ever seen his Twitter?
Yeah, he's a total dick on there.
He's really mean to people.
And he's really entertaining. Like, ridiculously entertaining. But it's not at all like how he acts on air. He's just like, you know, that a-hole friend that we all have, that we like them because you're super sarcastic and, like... take jabs at everybody, and you know they're not doing it out of spite or hatefulness, but they're just kind of haters, I guess. And that's sort of how he is. And then you have Dolph Ziggler, who's like, oh, yes, I like this TV show. Like, how does this make sense? They're supposed to be the opposite of this. Opposite. This is... all right. Well, anyway, this is where I wanted this topic to go tonight, John. I wanted to talk about this trend for heels to be just really wanting to be really well-liked while at the same time trying to be the bad guy. And it just, there's this weird conflict in there. I'd like to take that up a lot more with you here tonight, but first, this first song of the evening, this is from the band Jonesin from Dirt Cult Records. And the song is called Take Me to the Antique Roadshow. On Balling Shoe Handsome. That was Jonesin with Take Me to the Antique Roadshow. All right. So, Young John, when you think of great heels in the history of wrestling, who do you think of?
Great heels in wrestling. The guys that I grew up with, I'd have to say, you know, first one that comes to mind is Ric Flair.
All right. All right. So why was Ric Flair such a great heel?
Ric Flair wasn't a great heel. Ric Flair was the heel. Not particularly for me growing up because, you know, okay, we're from the northeast part of the U.S., so we mostly just had WWF, and WCW kind of came up as we were getting older.
Right.
But, you know, you'd always – that's the one guy you would hear about that wasn't in WWF was Ric Flair.
Right.
And he just – it seemed like he took bits of those old-school heels like the Gorgeous George, like Superstar Billy Graham, and he just created something. He was just – he was the heel.
Now, I think for a time – and, I mean, there's no disrespect to Ric Flair because, I mean, top three performers ever in the history of wrestling, maybe the top one and you take everything into account. But Ric Flair, even though he did some of those things that you're talking about, like the Gorgeous Georges and such did, Gorgeous George was legitimately hated. Ric Flair, when he first started – first coming up with the Horsemen in NWA, yeah, a big part of that crowd really just couldn't stand him, but – people grew to love him, and I think he played that up after a while. Ric Flair, honestly, is, to me, the prototypical cool heel. He's a guy that now there's no way he can get booed just because everybody loves him so much. And it's because he's this jet-flying, limousine-riding, and so on and so forth. He Yeah, I just took all the cool out of that.
That's how I remember it. That's how I remember it, and so on forth.
So on and so forth. Ooh. I'm going to use the phrase so on and so forth today. Woo! Greatest wrestler alive today. He's so Minnesotan. It's awesome. But, yeah, okay, I posit to you, Young John, that a better heel than Ric Flair,
okay,
overall, a better heel, not better wrestler, not better performer, not bigger legend in the history of this business.
Yar. It sounds like a dog, like you're trying to pull a dog's toy away from a dog.
So, wow, we are so infantile. Ted DiBiase is a better heel than Ric Flair.
Wow.
Ted DiBiase.
Bombshell much?
Look, it shouldn't be
a
bomb.
Son of a bitch. Go on. I'm enjoying this intelligent conversation.
It shouldn't be a bombshell, though. Why is that a bombshell? Ted DiBiase was consistently hated for his entire career. Now he comes out and he'll get a pop. Fine. But Ted DiBiase did not care. He not degraded himself. Like, he didn't make himself, you know, he wouldn't be effective if he degraded himself. But I guess what I'm saying is he didn't mind being embarrassed. Neither does Flair. My argument's looking a little thin here. But
I agree with you, of course.
DiBiase completely antagonized the crowd all the time. Ted DiBiase wasn't trying to say, look at me, look how awesome I am. He was trying to say, I think that the difference here is he was trying to say, don't look at me. You don't deserve to be able to look at me. You're a slob. I'm not. Not you want to be me, like you could never even think of being me. And there was this distinction where he separated himself from the crowd. That to me is the difference between a heel and a cool heel. I realize that even the cool heels say these sorts of things, but they don't say love me. Ted DiBiase didn't want the crowd's love, I guess is what I'm saying.
No, I totally agree with you. I was a huge fan of Ted. Well, I wasn't a huge fan of Ted DiBiase growing up because, you know, I was growing up, I was still young, and I was like,
you hated him.
Yeah, this guy is always in the middle of everything. And then when he had the $1 million corporation, he started buying everyone.
Right.
Yeah, it was looking back, it was great, and I agree with you. And in terms of the basic definition of a heel, he fits it. He's a prime example. But, you know, Flair, I don't know, he just went above and beyond it. I don't think anyone's ever touched the level that he's created. I feel like he's up there with like Joe DiMaggio and Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. He's just setting records that no one's going to touch.
Right, right. As a wrestler, definitely. As a performer overall. And you know what? I think the word created that you used there was apt, because DiBiase sort of came up with this thing that Flair came up with this thing that allowed DiBiase to sort of the heights that he did later. And they weren't the same heights Flair did. You know, he never went all the way up the ladder, so to speak. But yeah, Flair and the Horsemen were out with these legitimately upsetting most of these average Joes that were watching NWA. And why wouldn't they? Because they were being total assholes. They were going in and just, we're the Horsemen. We are far and away above everything here. We have all the women. You have none of the women. We ride in limousines. You drive your crappy old purple gremlins. I don't know if anyone actually drove a purple gremlin ever. Did that exist?
I could see Mick Foley in one.
Yeah, me too. I think he had a Yugo, if I'm not mistaken. I'll have to look that up. We need somebody on the Wikipedia for that. Clearly, that would be on his Wikipedia page. Personal life. Mick Foley's first car was a
purple gremlin.
All right. I just think DiBiase was more consistently heel, is I guess what I'm trying to say.
I could see that. I could definitely see that.
Not that he was better at it, but I think when you look back, Ric Flair, I mean, you look at Ric Flair the past 15, 20 years, he wasn't much of a heel at all.
This is true. Even when he was in Evolution, you know, you still kind of wanted to cheer him because he just seemed like he didn't belong in that group. It was just a bunch of up-and-comers and a Triple H who was it back then. And then it was Ric Flair, just kind of the comic relief.
But then again, isn't part of it that Flair was just so good at doing this stuff that he initially did to get the ire of the crowd that nothing he could do, he'd get booed? Isn't that worth pointing out, that he was so good as a heel that everyone loved him?
I suppose so, yeah.
Yeah, you know, it's not to say that, you know, any of these great movie villains, say like, you know, Pacino and Scarface, right?
Right.
You have like, a crowd can embrace something that's deplorable, but
it's all about how you play it.
Right. Right.
It's all about the game and how you play it.
I see what you did there. Now he's a car. I'm a car. Look at me. I'm a race car. All right.
So I have a little side question for you. Just give me a one sentence answer. Do you see this heel that you want to see? That's not the cool heel, like the heel that Ted DiBiase. Do you see room in the current WWE for a heel like that? Do you think they would succeed?
Whew. You know what? The way things are set up now, who knows? Who knows? I mean, you would think so. I think antagonists are important. I think you do see this to some degree in the authority figures. You know, the Laurinaitis, Vicky Guerrero formerly. So I think there's a place. But yeah, on one hand, it's sort of like, this isn't, you know, you're already in the arena having bought your ticket to the NWA event. This is like, you have to see this on TV and want to keep your TV on. So there has to be some level where the person engages you.
Right.
And if they, and we talked about this with Jericho before too. And interestingly enough, you described him as Jericho all these times. Jericho on his promo last Monday night actually did mention that he had trolled everybody. He used the word trolled.
Ah, see, there's our, I think Chris Jericho is one of our three listeners.
Ah, that poor thing.
And I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I'm all right with that. Let's. Isn't Chris Jericho the greatest of all time? All right. Well, actually, I want to get into Jericho in a few minutes, if you'll permit me. But
I will permit you.
Okay, but first I have to answer your question. Okay. I would say yes.
Okay.
Do you think there's room for the type of heel, the actual legitimate straight through heel in WWE?
You know, the size the size of these rosters, what the hell? You know, there's room for the creative team to try everything. How many shows do they have? Raw, SmackDown.
They have at least 27 shows operating each week.
And then they're going to have a whole network to themselves. What is the status of that, by the way?
Well, I did read earlier today that they're going to be adding two different weekly live shows that are not Raw and SmackDown that are going to be airing on the WWE Network.
Okay.
So there you go. There's plenty of television content.
Yeah.
And that's supposed to be coming late 2012, I believe. I think we could do a whole show on WWE Network, but I'm really interested to see how much this is going to cost. Because if this is the price of HBO, I don't think it's going to do too well. But if it's the price of, closer to what WWE 24/7 costs, it might be doable.
I actually have it's going to cost a lot of money.
How much?
I don't know. I just wanted to say that. A lot of money.
So you do or don't have the cost?
No, I don't have the cost.
Oh, all right. Anyway, all right. Chris Jericho.
Okay.
So,
never heard of him.
Never heard of him. Interesting. Interesting. How many conversations we've had about this guy then? Chris Jericho. Trolling aside, let's look at Chris Jericho, even because he's only been back for a little while. Let's look at Chris Jericho, not just today, maybe his last run in WWE as a heel.
Okay.
Versus Chris Jericho back in 2002 when he would come out and get the crowd to chant things about – well, no, I guess he wasn't doing as much chanting against Stephanie McMahon at that point. That's when he paired up with her. But think about the really – or maybe even a little later in 2002, 2003 or so, Chris Jericho and the highlight reel – and this super arrogant look at me, I'm a human highlight reel sort of thing. Do you think Chris Jericho doing these weird experimental things with the crowd, doing things deliberately just to not give them what they want, is a better heel than Chris Jericho who showed off all the time?
You know, I'm sure you know by now, my biggest Jericho era was him in WCW.
Okay.
When he was just the man in the cruiserweight division, and he had Ralphus following him around. I'm going to go with Jericho as a heel in 02, because that's as close to that WCW era Jericho as you're going to get.
Okay.
But with success, he was the undisputed champion back around that time, I believe.
He was, yeah.
You know, he was main eventing against The Rock and against, you know, Booker T, whoever was big back around then with the Invasion.
Right.
Having said that, you know, I'm happy to see him back. It seems like he's still in his in somewhat of a peak wrestling condition. You know, he's more of a technical guy anyway, so it can't be that tolling on your body to perform the technical moves and to take the occasional bump.
Well, I mean, it sort of depends, of course, like with anything else. But yeah, he's not going to need to do the high flying stuff that he did in WCW.
Right.
But I mean, it's good to see him back. Yeah, I'm interested in what he's going to do. I like what him and Punk have done the past couple of weeks. And I was not someone who wanted to see a Jericho Punk feud. I kind of think Punk doesn't need that feud with Jericho as much as some other guys do to elevate him. I think can do fine just sort of continuing along the way he has been by being kept vital as a champion, but I digress. Chris Jericho as a heel years ago was a little bit different, again, in that he was more of a show-off, appealed to like the smart crowd a little bit, even though he antagonized them sometimes. He knew that he had his fans in the crowd. He probably wanted to sell some t-shirts, and I think that's probably a topic worth getting into some other time too, just heels and merchandise sales, sort of a weird thing. But Jericho as a heel years ago played up to the crowd a little more as opposed to playing against them. You know what I mean?
Right.
And it's arguable that he was a much more entertaining entity at that point, but maybe now as a heel, in that he's already established himself, he can get fans a little bit more legitimately pissed off. You know, we love this type of Jericho. We want to see this type. Why are you giving us this type? I'm going to watch in hopes that we see the other type of Jericho, but until then, I'm going to boo the shit out of you.
And this is the type of heel that you were talking about to start the show. This is that heel who is just anti-crowd.
Right.
Not someone who's like, yeah, I don't, you know, we don't agree, but follow me on Twitter. This Jericho that's here now is the Jericho that's just...
Yeah.
There's no gray area.
Right.
He's a heel.
And Chris Jericho has a website, and it has, I'm sure it has a contact email on there and has plenty of information for fans. But, you know, he's not on there doing FAQs anymore. He's not doing anything, you know, and he would do some of this stuff years ago.
Okay.
I believe maybe in WCW, maybe a little later than that. But Chris Jericho engaged with that internet wrestling audience before, and he's not someone who does that now, and I think he doesn't need to, and it's probably better for his character if he doesn't. So it's interesting, and I realize I'm contradicting some stuff I said before, but you know, if he can pull this off, it's going to go well. You know, it'll be a good thing if he can make it work.
Yeah, I'm really interested to see where this goes. You know, at first everyone was just like, where the hell is this going?
Yeah, and it was boring TV. It was really boring TV.
Right, we were all thinking it's not going to end well. This is going to end the same way Mae Young ended having a hand as a baby.
Chris Jericho's going to have a hand as a baby? I'm kidding. It's...
Let's hear the next song. I don't want to hear you anymore.
All right, so this song is from local Philadelphia act Dear Althea. Great band, and this is a live version of their song, Am I Hollow? Am I Hollow by Dear Althea on Bowling Show.
I want to crawl beneath the skin to find out what's within. Yeah.
love that song. Am I Hollow by Philadelphia act Dear Althea. They are going to be playing at Kung Fu Necktie here in Philadelphia on February 25th. I know I'm going to be there. John, I hope you're able to make it out as well.
Yeah, I said I'm attending on the Facebook page.
There you go.
What part of that don't you understand?
Most of it, apparently.
I'm not mad at you anymore, Kevin.
Good, good. Because you'd be a real-life heel if you're going to do that.
Oh.
Run sheets.
It all comes together. The cheddar comes together.
John, are you a fan of Storage Wars?
I've never seen.
Okay, on Storage Wars, there's this character named Dave Hester. He is this obnoxious, nerdy guy who's really good at deciding which storage units. For those who haven't seen the show, the premise is that there's these different people who try to purchase these auctioned off storage units and then resell the stuff in the units to make money. So Dave Hester is sort of the heel on this show. In fact, there's no sort of about it. Everybody else is likable to some degree, except this guy who's total, total arrogant. Just whatever nasty word you want to assign to him. You know, he's awful, but he's really good at what he does. And he even has an annoying catchphrase, and he sells – he just – when he's raising his bid, he goes, yep. And he has a hat that says, yep, that he wears while he's doing this. You can buy the hat. He's totally a pro wrestling heel, and he's doing this better than half of the WWE guys. And I'm actually kind of sad you haven't seen this, John, because this is I should have prepped you and asked you to watch an episode, because this guy is a consummate heel.
You said Dave Hebner?
Dave – not Dave Hebner. No, he's not selling merchandise that stolen from his company. He's selling his own merchandise.
Oh, I see.
Dave Hester.
Okay. And that's all I got. Good night.
Yeah. Anyway. I'm glad you had that much. Yep. Anyway. So him, you know, I think – remember when – you know, remember when Kevin Federline was in WWE a number of years back?
Yeah, it was like brief. Yeah, he wrestled on New Year's Day.
Yep. And yep. And Federline.
The hell.
Yeah, the show has gone downhill.
Let me give you an Andy Bernard quote. What the hell?
The Bing. And all right, never mind. Yep. So Kevin Federline, the reason he worked so well as a heel, and I really wish he'd stuck around and been a manager for somebody for a while, such as Umanga.
He was
so good because people legitimately hated him, and he didn't come out and try to say, but wait, I'm just this guy who has this amount of success. He come out and like, yeah, I was married to Britney Spears. Yeah, I'm rich because of my divorce. Yeah, I'm going to come out here with an unwashed shirt. He really didn't care. He did not care if a single person in that crowd liked him, and that is what made him awesome. He just didn't care how many douche chills he sent out to the crowd. And
good term.
It was just, man, it was, you know, he was a consummate heel. And I really think, you know, you have someone, say if you had someone like, I don't know if the situation's probably unfortunately too popular right now to bring him on. But there's got to be some people that you can capitalize on the amount of real life heat they have and then bring them in.
Well, you know? Has Mark Cuban ever been on a WWE program?
Very briefly. Randy Orton gave him the stunner, actually.
Nice.
The stunner, yeah. Wow, the RKO.
The stunner.
Come on. Long weekend.
It's the Diamond Cutter, Kevin. Stunner, this guy. Yeah, I feel like Mark Cuban really fits that. You know, he's really calmed down in the recent years, and now that he won the championship with the Mavs, he's really calmed down. Actually, no, he hasn't. He's got fine this season, so I take it
there
back.
You go.
You know, but somebody like Mark Cuban, Ron Artest.
I think he took the RKO in Dallas, if I remember right.
Nice.
So, I mean, there's kind of like mixed. I'm sure there's, you know, actually, I can't speak because not being from Dallas, I don't know if there's a love-hate relationship with him or what it is.
Well, they probably love him right now. They just won the championship. So.
Right. Yeah, it's different. Yeah. When success changes people's minds about a lot of things.
Yeah.
I remember how upset a lot of people were when Michael Vick signed to the Eagles, but then when he started winning, you know, people's minds get changed sometimes.
Yeah. Using the word minds and Philly sports fans in the same sentence usually doesn't go well. And you can't possibly be offended by that because you know.
No, I know firsthand. Yeah.
Yeah.
My mom got hit in the head with a bottle at an Eagles game when I was like 3 or 4 years old. So I'm not too keen on Philly sports fans.
Well, yeah, I believe it.
Yeah. No offense, young John. I'm not lumping you in.
Hey.
Yeah. To an extent, you know, I still watch some baseball, so I still have to put myself in with Philly sports fans.
There's no way I'm offended by that.
All right. Well, good. Or else you'd be a real-life heel. Ah, full circle. Average Pennywise.
Sigh. I can't sigh enough.
Can we get, in between segments, can we get the Haruka sound to be applied?
No. Birdman!
Bowling Shoe Handsome is over. No, not quite. We still have another song to go to. Shall we do that now?
Let's do it now.
Jack Smirking Revenge, strangely meta on Bowling Shoe Handsome.
When we were growing up, I don't think any single one of us had lofty dreams of one day. Of one day being a wage slave. Is this what we've been reduced to? Is this the Western progress of humanity? Useless generations raised to answer phones, wait tables, and sling coffee. Selling our time, our souls, our bodies, just to pay rent. When our parents told us that one day we would grow up, they didn't mention that this is what they meant. Writing down tens of pounds on my waist log when I can't afford to eat. Busking for change on my days off. Would any yuppies mind buying me a drink? I shouldn't mind this degradation. We all go through it at some point in our life. But I can't seem to get my mind on better things I could be doing with my time. But it doesn't have to be this way. We can reclaim our humanity, we can end this monotony. We can scream into their faces, I'm a goddamn human being. My life is worth more than this paycheck to paycheck living.
That was Strangely Meta by Jack's Smirking Revenge. Appropriate, the show is very meta. I'm a meta, you're a meta.
I'm a meta girl in a meta world.
All right, do you have a background this week, young John?
I do have a background this week. It's Kesha. Have you ever heard of Kesha?
She did that Party in the USA song, right?
No. She did, shit, I can't... Oh. Bleep it out.
That's okay. I dropped one earlier. We'll let that go this week.
I was trying to think of another teeny bopper song that wasn't her, but I couldn't.
I Think We're Alone Now by Tiffany was by Kesha.
Yeah, there you go. I like how you say the artist, then you're just like, oh, by Kesha. Anyway.
The Andrew Jackson Jihad has a song called Zombie by the Cranberries by Andrew Jackson Jihad, and it's not at all a cover of Zombie by the Cranberries.
Nice.
Yeah, nice.
Daddy-like. Kesha.
But she's hot.
Excuse me. Kesha got a stunning makeover by Glamour magazine, and she's only 24 years old. And when you think of Kesha, you just think of this.
Blah. The finest music ever recorded.
Yes, wow. that too. But you just think of this trashy girl with glitter all over her. She cleaned up very nicely. And I put a picture on the run sheet that you can fap to.
Oh, jeez. Say that and then say no sexist. You know how people say no homo sometimes. No. Okay.
you're a horrible person.
I don't. Whatever. I'm just trying to. I'm trying to distance myself.
Yeah.
No. It's all right. So
she cleaned them nicely, didn't she?
Yeah. Yeah. I guess. Eh.
Yeah.
I don't care anyway. I don't. Whatever. Like I would react if I had a reaction. I don't have a reaction. I'm sorry.
Well then, if you.
Live my life my own way.
I can live my life my own way if I want to. F off.
I don't I'm actually searching. The Grammys are airing as we're recording this, and I just searched for Kesha for any sign of her on the show. It doesn't look like anything yet.
Yeah.
It looks like Adele has won exactly 46 Grammys so far tonight. So good for her.
How is she going to sing? She just got vocal surgery.
I heard. Yeah, that's a shame, too. Like, right as she's taken off, too.
No, but she's gotten a few vocal surgeries. She shouldn't be performing this soon. The doctor said wait a year, and that was in, like, November.
You know, interesting fact. What's it? Bonnie, is it Tyler who did Total Eclipse of the Heart?
Yes.
Yes. Did you know that her voice wound up the way it was because she sang too soon after a vocal surgery? Like, she has that very raspy. And I mean, Adele has kind of like a little bit of a raspy voice, but not like Bonnie Tyler does.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that was actually because she ignored doctor's orders and sang too soon after surgery. It's a lot of stuff.
Well, it's probably not good for you, though, you know?
No, it's definitely not. What I'm saying is Adele, that would really mess with the sound of her voice.
Yeah, exactly.
And, I mean, she's doing well. She, you know, and she deserves it. You know, she's worked hard, and she's been doing this for a number of years. It would be a shame if something. And, I mean, let's not forget for health reasons, you know? So.
Yeah. I work with a lot of college girls at my job. Huh. And
right.
I was working last night. And, you know, once Whitney Houston, everyone found out Whitney Houston passed away, a lot of the girls, one of the girls said, that sucks for Adele. And I said, what does that mean? What are you talking about? She said, well, you know, tomorrow night's the Grammys and it was going to be all about Adele. And now that just got taken away from her because Whitney Houston died. And oh. I thought that was pretty funny, but at the same time. It doesn't suck for Adele.
I've heard that a few times. It's basically they're saying that's going to overshadow the Grammys. But you know what? That's how it is. You know, sometimes things happen.
Life. That's life.
You know, think about like a lot of times people. You know, they might be getting married and they lose a loved one. You know,
right.
That's probably worse than having your Grammys overshadowed by. I mean, no disrespect to Adele. I just give her props for what she's been doing.
Right. There's a difference.
The props were provided by Carrot Top. Thank you, Carrot Top.
Yes.
Bow and arrow through the head and the.
I'm sorry we couldn't bring on Gallagher props for this show, but gotta live in the now, right?
Yeah. Didn't he sell his act to his brother or something? So there's two Gallaghers going around. Did I hear that?
Have you seen this? Have you heard about this?
I seriously think I heard that.
I don't. I've never heard this before. It's pretty funny if it's true. Of course, I'm looking at his. Wikipedia right now. Oh, you're right. Wow.
When did this this show get its own lights out segment?
I don't know.
I'm pretty sure this has been three times the length of the actual show.
I'm reading about his accusations of racism and homophobia.
By Gallagher?
Yeah.
Really? That I don't ever want to see a watermelon smashed then if if that's the man that's doing it. Maybe his brother's. Oh my, his Wikipedia picture is ridiculous.
Yes, it is. That's how I want
and
to like
for the guy with that act to to be racist and homophobic. That's a pretty strong example of a real life heel there. Wow. Anyway, I'm reading this now. This is wow. Whoa. Wow.
Well, this is making for great radio.
That's some awful stuff. If you want to be offended, go read Gallagher's Wikipedia page. Wow. Anyway, do you have anything else to add about the world of music, wrestling, television, or the circus? I don't know. Wrestling is circus. Life's a circus.
The wrestling circus. No, I'm all good. I might watch the Grammys tonight now that you mention it. I don't listen to any type of new music at all, but I'll watch for the girls.
Ew, all of my music came out before 1981, and it's all on vinyl. Or 8-track tape. 8-tracks are back in now.
More like 2002, but I see what you're doing.
Yeah. So we're still waiting for those. We're still waiting for those promise ring dates to be announced.
Yeah, seriously.
Yeah, they're playing New York.
Although I'm not even really into shows anymore. It just they were hurting my knees standing up, you know, like 5-10 years ago. At this point, I'm just gonna sit in my rocking chair and
complain about the kids.
Yes, complain about the kids, and have buy a screen door for my room.
Sit there eating your chewable Werther's Originals. Drinking your Canada Dry from the can with a straw,
or eating
one of the straws with the red and the green stripes on them.
Oh my god.
I
was about to say something else, but I'm just gonna hold it in.
Okay,
let's do Lights Out, Kevin.
All right, Lights Out. All right, and that does it for Bowling Shoe Handsome. Join us again here next week on YouTube, youtube.com, and user BSH Podcasts, also found at, of course, thebradyhicks.com. And thanks once again. We'll talk to you next week. Leave us some feedback in the comments section or drop us an email at bowlingshoehandsome@gmail.com. For Young John, I'm Kevin McElvaney. Thanks for listening to Bowling Shoe Handsome.
So don't ask me how I am. Don't ask me how I am.